Welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake. Also live over SPNN in St. Paul. And we've got an interesting show for you today. People always come up to me during close to election time and say, "Oh, these judges, what judges should we vote for? I don't know anything about them." Well, today, no excuses, okay? I'm going to show you where you can find out about the judges and who's running for office, at least where you can start the process of your research on candidates, and specifically for state rep, state senate, and statewide races. For judges. So I'm going to walk you through that process so you have no excuse. I don't know what to do. First of all, anybody can go to the Secretary of State's website, and that's where I'm going to take you. So we'll walk through that. Then I just started last week on this letter from the president of the American College of Pediatricians about gender ideology and how it harms children, and that it harms children. And so we'll go into that in a little more depth, especially for any school board individual. They need to hear this. They need to understand what's going on so that they, if they hear this, they can't be that naive as to how things really are. And I think if you hear this, you'll understand, and this will give you talking points as to how to deal with this issue of transgender in school or gender fluidity. What's really going on, and why are they using the word gender rather than sex? So we'll talk about that. That's going to be the big issues today. But before we get into that, remember, if you got a comment or questions, call in 651-747-3838. You can see past shows on youtube.com/speechlessmn. And if you want to send me some emails, there's the email down there, speechlessmn@gmail.com. And I appreciate it. I tell you, get out in the community once in a while and people walk up to you and say, "I watch your show." Way to go. And I was at the Blacksmith Car Show, and somebody there, that's up in Hugo, somebody there said, "Hey, I watch your show. I really like it. You got guts. I can't believe you're doing what you're doing." So I just appreciate it. Of course, I realize there are detractors there that can't stand the show. Well, that's all right. That's what makes America great. We can dissent and assent. And we don't have to kill each other for that, right? Let's hope not. Wonderful. Oh man, the cars at the Blacksmith Car Show, unbelievable. And Lauren Cedarstrom on the All Around Grant Show is going to show you some clips that he took up there and the interviews he did with people on some of these cars that were just fantastic. Original cars and original condition with some touch up, just amazing that some of these cars could last so long. You'll see those on All Around Grant once in a while, or at least one a month for a while. Okay, I also want to get you familiar, and we talk about the Muslim Islam issue in the United States as far as refugees coming into the United States, how they're taking over certain populations. Just saw a Muslim woman in a police outfit at around Maplewood Mall today, had her burqa on. And so how's that going to affect our culture? There's a man out there named Randall Terry who's doing a whole series on what would Muhammad do. And I just want to show you an introduction to his series so that you can understand what, I mean, it's a powerful series, but he is asking the key question that needs to be asked. Not only what would Muhammad do, but why is, what is the central issue that is causing Muslims to behead people, to be at war with people, to be at war with their own people? And so we're going to show that video here, and he's got a 9-part series that he's doing, but I'm just going to show you the trailer to it. So let's play it here.
I also want to speak tonight directly to Muslims throughout the world. We respect your faiths. His teachings are good and peaceful. And those who commit evil in the name of Allah blaspheme the name of Allah.
Islam is a religion of peace. They are not Muslims. They are monsters.
At the same time, we have reaffirmed again and again that the United States is not and never will be at war with Islam. Islam teaches peace.
No, we are at war. New York. Boston. San Bernardino. Paris. Brussels. Madrid. London. Sydney. All over the world, Muslim terrorists are killing or enslaving their victims. Why? What motivates ISIS, Al-Qaeda, the Muslim Brotherhood, and so-called lone wolves? The answer lies in the life of one man, Muhammad, the founder of Islam. Why do Muslim terrorists behead their hostages? Why do they murder people who satirize Muhammad in cartoons? Why do they take women as sexual slaves? Why do they have such deep hatred for the Jewish people? Because Muhammad did. Muslim terrorists have not hijacked the peaceful religion of Islam. They are following the example of its founder. Over 9 episodes, we will study different aspects and events of Muhammad's life, events that form the central motivating narrative for Muslim terrorists. In each episode, we will find out why Muslim terrorists believe their atrocities are ordered by God. You will learn how terrorists read ancient Islamic literature that they believe justifies their violence to non-believers. You will witness Muhammad's hatred of the Jewish people and how that continues to this very day. We will pull back the veil on the long history of sexual slavery and violence against women that has been committed since the dawn of Islam. If we hope to win this war, we must know our enemy, because Muslim terrorists are already fighting to the death, whether we believe in Muhammad or not.
Okay. That's What Would Muhammad Do? Shadow of the Sword. I think he brings out the most important thing. You got to look at Muhammad. That's who they look at. As Christians look at Jesus, Islamists, Muslims look at Muhammad and see what he did. Christians look at Jesus and see what Jesus did. And to think that there isn't a difference would be just inaccurate. So what would a Muslim say about another Muslim who isn't in jihad mode. They would call them apostates, and that's why you have Muslims fighting Muslims, because they're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. So, Voice of Resistance, you Google that, Voice of Resistance, or Randall Terry, What Would Muhammad Do? And this will come up, and you can educate yourself. And you can say, yeah, it's this way, no, it's not that way. But just understand, what would Muhammad do? Look at his life and see what he would do. And it's a fascinating series. You're going to get a lot of good information, a lot of interesting information. And then you can talk to your Muslim friends about it. Is this true? Is this the way it is? You know, research, read the Quran for yourself. Find out what it says. Find out what the Hadith says about Muhammad's life. Because that, it's not just the Quran, it's also the Hadith, and it will, there's a lot to read, no doubt about it, there's a whole lot to read. Okay, well, let's find out who's running for office in our area, and I'm going to show you this page here first. This is the page we're looking for, if we can bring that up on the screen. It's coming. Okay, this is the Minnesota Office of the Secretary of State, and this is the candidate filing area for the state 2016 general election. Okay, so, and below here, it gives you the time and place as to when candidates can file, and on the basic search, you can do, you know, judicial offices, state senate office, state executive offices, state representative offices. But how do you get there? That is the question. And when I came into the show today, because I'd been doing this all week, last week, it's just going to be really easy to go find. Well, now it's not so easy. So I'm going to show you the process to go find it. So if we start a new tab here, I'm just going to type in the browser there, MN, Minnesota Secretary of State. And you can spell it all out if you want. You don't need to. Push return. And there's a, you see a link there to Minnesota Secretary of State. Click that, and you get the home page. Okay. And you think you, and it used to be the first thing that popped up. Look at the candidates who have filed. Well, now we got to go to elections and voting. Actually, I don't remember where we have to go to. Boy, this isn't easy as it was before. Let's see, let's go to more. No, that's not it. Oh boy. Something that used to be very easy for all these years has now suddenly become difficult. Become a candidate. Let's click more here. All right, become a candidate. Let's see there. Oh, here we go. So you go to Secretary website, click on become a candidate, search candidate findings, filings, and there we got that same site there. Okay. So, let's look here at the big question that comes up. I don't know anything about the judiciary. Who should I vote for? So let's go here. Judicial offices. Click on that. Oh, look at here. Every person that's running for office as a judicial candidate will be listed right there. Okay, so that you just have their name there. Okay, but you'll see, like for the Minnesota Supreme Court, you have Craig Foss, he's underlined, Natalie Hudson. Okay, they're all going to be underlined because they had to file some information. So if we go to Craig Foss, we see he's got name, his resident address, which he's putting as a It's really a business address when I looked that up. So no website, no voluntary disclosure, no campaign address. Okay, so not much information on him, but you have a name, so then you can go out and Google the name. Who's Craig Foss? You know, try to find out some more information about him. Well, let's go to Natalie Hudson here for the Supreme Court. So we got the same type of information, resident address not required. I think you'll find sitting candidates will not put an address. They may not. Campaign address. And then we got a website here, justicehudson.org. And then you can go to the website, and then you can find out about at least what Natalie has to say about Natalie. Okay? And you can find some information about her there. So that doesn't mean you can't do other searching on her website or other articles on the web or whatever, but there's a place to begin. Okay, and the same with, let's go here to Michelle McDonald, and she has a website, McDonald for Justice, campaign address there, and you can click on that, and there you have her website and can find out information there. Okay. All right. So anyway, that's the Minnesota Supreme Court, and it's seat number 6 out of 7. There's only one open for election. Could have been 2, but Justice Dietzen decided to resign from office, not fulfill his term, and not stand for re-election, or he decided to quit early in order that Governor Dayton could appoint rather than have an election for his seat. He could have resigned on December 31st or January 1st, had that seat open for an election, and it could have been a contested seat. And instead, what's happened here now, supposedly the Minnesota judiciary was controlled by Republicans. There was a Republican majority. But when Dietzen resigned, that allowed Dayton to appoint, and because it was a 4-3 majority for the Republicans, now it's a 4-3 majority for the Democrats. And so with Dietzen being appointed by Republican governors, now is letting Dayton appoint, and Dayton's going to appoint a Democrat. I mean, is anybody fooled by that? You don't think he's going to appoint a pro-choice candidate? You know, pro-big spending, pro-government spending, going to twist the rules and the laws according to the Democratic platform and policies? Anybody doubt that? You know, if you do, I got news for you. You know, because remember this, and this is a key point, and this is what people don't understand. Okay, well, I think a lot of people in the governmental process understand that, but not the bottom line voter. They don't understand this very well. The judiciary only has to give a pretense for following the law. And then all you have to do is be in the majority. That's what our judicial system is about. And that's why district court judges are so important, because most people don't get beyond the district court judge because it's expensive to appeal the case, not only once to the appellate courts, where you get 3 judges to look at the case. Not all of it, but just the legal aspects of the case. Not so much the findings of fact, unless there's abuse of discretion. And then it's the 3 majority that or 2-1 majority that have to give a pretense to following the law. But with their pretense, they win. Okay? Well, you could appeal that to the Minnesota Supreme Court. They may or may not take up the case. But again, you only need a 4-3 majority with the pretense to following the law or saying what the law means. So this whole idea that you're going to get an independent judge, nonpartisan, bunch of baloney. Don't believe it for a second. Okay? You want to get a judge that's going to follow your values, your ideals, and make a constitutional argument for it, and then have the majority vote. That's how it works. I mean, bring the person to me, callers call in, tell me different. Tell me it doesn't work that way. You can tell me that, but I don't think you have a basis for it. You know, you will find justices that will go out and, you know, many times they'll come to unanimous decisions because it's beneficial for everybody to do that. Nobody's harmed by that unanimous decision. And it gives them the cover to look like they're really following the law. And in that case, they may be, you know, they may not be. But, you know, that's part of the deal. Okay, so let's go back to this chart here. So you have the Supreme Court justice, but now you have the Court of Appeals, and there's, I think, 19 seats in the Court of Appeals. And we see here that none of the Court of Appeals people have a candidate running against them. Okay, none of them. I think there was 9 seats or 11 seats. Let's see, 9 seats in the appellate court that were up for election. Nobody challenged them. 9 of these 11, I believe, were at least 8 of these 11 were plenty appointees. I was surprised that there weren't any Democrats that ran against them, but somebody could really question whether some of these plenty appointees were really Republicans, especially how they ruled on family law issues, where they could have easily given strength to the family based on our Constitution and United States history, but have not done so. And you have a number, and then a couple Dayton appointees in there. And a couple, this is the appellate court. Okay, so then after that, you get into the district. So here we see your first district, Court 17. You know, in the whole first judicial district, nobody challenged anybody. Left unchallenged. Now remember, all these candidates, all these sitting judges get the word incumbent behind their name. Let's go to the second judicial district, which is Ramsey County, and we see here that again, nobody is challenged in the second judicial district. Now there were some people that were inquiring and thinking of running, but they chose not to run. Now, until we get into third judicial district, do we see some competition coming on? And there's 5 judges in the third district, 5 seats in the third district that are up for, have challengers. Some of these seats were, very much, the judge left the seat and is leaving it open for an election. So we see in seats where there was no incumbent judge running, then you see people running for that office. Okay? So it's not that people don't want to run for judge. They don't want to run for judge with the name incumbent on there. And I was talking with one person running for judge, and they had to consider that, and they also had to consider if it was going to affect their, how it would affect their business in a negative light. whether other judges would approve of it. And there is a situation where judges will get together and say, hey, we need to find somebody to run against this other judge because they're just really bad, or we don't like them. And then that individual will get permission to run from the judges, and they won't throw their cases. Okay, let's switch it back to me. We got a caller here. Caller, do you got a comment or question?
Two questions.
Yes.
First of all, if you can make comment, as I was listening to you describing the people who are running unopposed, it reminded me of life term appointments. So could you, like for the Supreme Court and the federal judges, so can you comment about that, if you believe that really it's a lifetime appointment in a way? Secondly, I've heard this, that if a judge, like the third district that you just talked about, there are a number of open seats. It's because the judge probably said, hey, it's important to have an open election. But isn't there a process where a judge can resign and then the governor can make an appointment and there is no election? I've heard about that. So if you could please make it, you know, those two questions or points, if you could share your comments on that.
Sure. Yeah, and this is really about the history of judicial elections and appointments. Why Minnesota state is different than the federal government, and why many states are different than the federal government. The federal government does give lifetime appointments to the judiciary. And at the time, the talk was the judiciary is the weakest link of the three part of our judicial, of our former government, the executive branch, the legislative branch being the strongest, and the executive being the second strongest, and the judiciary being the weakest. Over time, that has changed, where the judiciary has become a very, very strong branch of government, so much so that the other branches are afraid of the judiciary to some extent. So lifetime appointments there, but now we have in Minnesota a different situation. The United States had existed for a while, a little under 100 years. Minnesota state comes into existence, they write a constitution, but just before Minnesota came into existence, there was a Supreme Court decision called the Dred Scott decision. Minnesota was a very anti-slavery state. Dred Scott had moved to Minnesota, got married, and Minnesota considered him a citizen. But Missouri came and took him and kept him as a slave, and that went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court. And the U.S. Supreme Court said he needs to remain as a slave. And so the people in Minnesota, at least enough of them, had an outcry and established, when they established their constitution, realized they needed to have a way to have some type of checks and balances on the judiciary. So they established judicial elections so that they could vote judges out of office, who make laws and who make laws that are just against the people. And so elections then became an option in Minnesota as a form of checks and balances. However, it has been rarely used because of the power of the judiciary in Minnesota. Now, understand, that's one form of checks and balances, but, you know, where we get to elect judges, but there's the way our Constitution was written, there's a way for the lawyers and the judiciary to override the election process, and that's to have a vacancy in office for whatever reason. So a judge can die, judge can retire, resign, be disqualified. Whatever happens, never sign their oath of office, and they would then the office would be vacated, and that vacation of office led the governor to be able to appoint for that seat. And then all of a sudden, the system, the judicial system, realized, oh, we can just avoid elections altogether by just keep appointing. And then we could put pressure on lawyers not to run against us. And the Minnesota judiciary created a underground system of intimidation and threats to make sure lawyers didn't run against sitting judges. And as you will should very well understand, and I forgot to do this, but Michelle McDonald, she was threatened severely by an operative working on behalf of the Republican, the high echelons of the Republican Party, and threatened that her career and her family would be destroyed if she did not resign her endorsement, which she didn't. And then the Republican Party just attempted from there on out to destroy her. That gets lost in the shuffle of what's going on here. But other lawyers see this happen and they go, boy, I don't really want to do this. This could affect my practice and my clients. So even though we don't have life-term appointments, we end up with a life-term appointment-like system in our judiciary. And the House of Representatives is, two things happen, too afraid to do anything about any checks and balances through impeachment. We have impeachment, which the House of Representatives has to do. And also they're not aware of it. And typically at the state level, people running for office do not understand the judicial part of the government unless they're a lawyer. And there's not many lawyers in the legislature anymore. There was at one time in recent history a lot of lawyers. And then we went down to a way low number, and actually good things started happening. And now it's starting to climb back up. But these lawyers are under pressure. One, they can't say anything disparaging about the courts against their code of ethics. And so the judiciary establishes a code of ethics that really prohibits getting knowledge out about the people, about the judiciary. But if they do, it's more about a candidate and disparaging a candidate, like is going on with Michelle McDonald. This one article here from MinPress, let's see who was this, MinPost, just keeps saying over and over again that McDonald was unqualified. Well, how do you define unqualified? Because she meets all the definitions that are required to be a Minnesota Supreme Court justice. She's qualified. So in their situation, unqualified means they don't like her. Okay? That's what it means. So who gets to determine whether a justice is qualified or unqualified? The voters do. That's who gets to decide. So in Minnesota here, we now see these governors appointing time after time after time. And where the Republican Party has made a big mistake on this is that state after state where the Republican Party does endorse judges and does support candidates running for judicial office, they win. And our state is pretty evenly divided, so if we had conservative justices running in conservative areas, they would win their races. So about half the state would be conservative justice, half of it would be liberal. And then you'd have a real battle of ideas taking place in our courthouse, and the intimidation factor should go down. But Republican Party doesn't get that. The DFL party gets, we can endorse by having all our statewide offices, all our local officers, city council members, county commissioners. We can have them individually endorse all these candidates and send a message, but the Republican Party doesn't get that. So anyway, an open seat, as the caller was talking about, allows candidates to run for judge where they don't have to run against the word incumbent, and they don't have to kick out a sitting judge. And the justices are really only mad at the judicial candidate who left the office or is leaving the office open for the election. Those justices probably will not get retirement jobs. They will not get the, you know, when the court gets a busy calendar, they won't be called in to be a star judge or be a retired judge to handle overload cases. And maybe those justices don't want that, but word on the street, that's part of the game that goes on in our judiciary. So the other issue about that open election seat is that justice stepping down, and there I go, I forgot my point. There's so many points on this. I'll remember it someplace. Winning election becomes very, very difficult to do against a sitting judge, and that's why it ends up being a lifetime appointment, because of all the system involved in place. So anyway, there you can see all your candidates running for office, and there's not many. So some of you, like in Ramsey County, or the second judicial district, which is mostly the Ramsey County, there's a little part of the fifth congressional district in the Ramsey County area, second judicial district. You won't be voting for a judge except at the Supreme Court level. That's the only place. But the third judicial district, and I don't think the 10th judicial district had any challengers. Let me go real quick here. No, lot of seats open in the 10th judicial district. I mean, candidates, but yeah, nobody challenged. So there won't be anybody to vote for. And so there you see the lifetime appointment going on there. Okay, that's how, that was about the judicial races, but you may say, well, I don't know anything about any other race. Well, let's look at state senate offices. So let's go back to the computer here and look at the state senate offices. There we go. So, of course, we clicked under judicial offices before. Now we go to state senate offices, and you'll find out everybody running for state senate. Now, here's a interesting one that comes right off the top. You'll see there's two Republican candidates for District 1, two Republican and two DFL. That means there's going to be a primary in that race. And we see it's interesting here, Mark Johnson, Republicans, already got a website, 5/26. He was the filing date. Edwin Dale Hahn, 5/31. So he signed up the last day possible. The same with this Joel Carlson, signed up the last day possible, where the other candidates signed up before that. I suppose the ones that signed up before were the endorsed candidates, and somebody decided to challenge them. So some of the things you can infer by the dates of when they filed. So let's see some local races here. Senate District 43. Oh, this is interesting. Didn't know this happened. Well, now this would be the White Bear Lake, Oakdale, Maplewood, North St. Paul, Matamidi, Willerney area. We have a three-person race here. So Chuck Weger, Democrat for former labor, who's the sitting candidate, he signed up on 517. And here we got Bob Zick signed up as a Republican. He signed up on 531. And Chris Belfour, Independence Party, signed up on 527. That's interesting because on 531, I was looking at this, and even the day before, and Chris Belfour did not show up on the list. So I don't know what happened there. Maybe he was there, maybe he wasn't, but I don't remember seeing him there. So anyway, in this area, we're shooting out of here. We got three. So Bob Zick, who does a show Wednesday night, 8:30 here, Inside Insight, is running against Chuck Weger along with Chris Belfour, whoever that is. So that's going to be no primary, and it's going to be a three-way race in the general election. Interesting thing going on there. So you can find out whatever area you're in, and you kind of got to figure out, you know, it says District 35. Well, you got to know where District 35 is. And you need to know that if you're going to engage the governmental process. Okay, let's go to state representative offices, and since we're looking at Senate 43, let's look at House 43. Okay, Bob Cardinal and Peter Fisher. So that's going to be a two-man race in the general elections here. And then we go down here, Nathan Hansen against Leon Lilly. Nathan Hansen's attorney out of North St. Paul. He ran against Leon Lilly before. So he's doing it again. Nathan Hansen is an attorney who just won a case where somebody was being charged with second degree murder, and the person was found not guilty. Nathan Hansen also defended on the, you can bring the video back to me, also defended an individual with a raw milk situation who was producing raw milk and selling it to select clients, and won a case on that. Of course, it's in our Constitution, you know, that you get to do this, but what does a state care about our Constitution? What do these judiciary care about that? You know, that's why your judiciary makes a difference and their ideology makes a difference, because they'll just give a pretense of law if they don't like what's in your favor. And if you get judges who are committed to following the Constitution, not to the best of their ability, but are committed to following the Constitution, we'll see a different outcome in our cases, and then we'll know what laws to change or what part of the Constitution to change. But as long as we're playing all these games, who knows? Okay, well, that's all we're going to do on that for now, because I want to get to this gender ideology stuff. But there's no excuse. You have no excuse for not knowing who your candidates are for the state races. And next week, you know, I tried to look up Ramsey County, you know, and it's not there. Who's your county commissioners? You know, I looked all over trying to find out what are the races for county commissioners, and it's not there. You can't find the list. Maybe it is, but it's not easy to find. And where it used to be easy on the Secretary of State, it's not as easy anymore. So you're going to have to do a little work, and the best thing to do is call them, call the Secretary of State, call Ramsey County or Washington County or whatever county you're in, and say, where can I find the list of candidates who are running? And they should be able to tell you what that is. Okay, let's get to this. This is for St. Paul schools. You need to know this. Gender ideology harms children. And the main thing here you need to know is that human sexuality is an objective biological binary trait. XY and XX are genetic markers of health, not genetic markers of a disorder. The norm for human design is to be conceived either male or female, and it also takes a male or and a female to conceive. You gotta have one sex or the other, okay? You come out transgender, uh-uh. You come out one sex or the other. And it takes one, both of each sex in order to make one or the other. Okay, that's just the way it is. The norm for human design is to be conceived either male or female. Human sexuality is binary by design, and the obvious purpose being the reproduction and flourishing of our species. This principle is self-evident. The exceedingly rare disorder of sex development, DSDs, including but not limited to testicular feminization and congenital adrenal hyperplasia, are all medically identifiable deviations from the sexual binary norm and are rightly recognized as disorders of human design. Individuals with DSDs do not constitute a third sex. It's not a third sex, okay? This is done by the president of the American College of Pediatricians, the vice president, and also a professor of psychiatry at Johns Hopkins Medical School, and the former psychiatrist in chief at Johns Hopkins Medical School. Second issue is no one is born with a gender. Everyone is born with a biological sex. Gender, an awareness and sense of oneself as male or female, is a sociological and psychological concept, not an objective biological one. No one is born with an awareness of themselves as male or female. This awareness develops over time, and, like all developmental processes, may be derailed by a child's subjective perceptions, relationships, and adverse experiences from infancy forward. People who identify as feeling like the opposite sex or somewhere in between do not comprise a third sex. They remain biological men or biological women. Doesn't matter what your brain tells you you think you are. By your sex, you're either a man or a woman. I don't know. Maybe these truths are just hard to hear. And I don't know why they would be. But, you know, and let's say they are hard to hear. There's help. Okay? There's people that care, that want to help people that are confused on this issue. And I don't want to be perceived as looking down on an individual that may be thinking or confused in their mind as to about what they are. I don't want to be looking down on that individual. I want to help that individual and know that we can get them help and that they can get help with that. Okay, it will help them greatly. Okay, third issue, a person's belief that he or she is something they are not is, at best, a sign of confused thinking. When an otherwise healthy biological boy believes he is a girl, or an otherwise healthy biological girl believes she is a boy, an objective psychological problem exists that lies in the mind, not the body. and it should be treated as such. These children suffer from gender dysphoria. Gender dysphoria, formerly listed as gender identity disorder, is a recognized mental disorder in the most recent edition of Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of the American Psychological Association. That's the DSM-5. This psychodynamic and social learning theories of gender dysphoria, have never been disproved. Okay, fourth issue. Puberty is not a disease, and puberty-blocking hormones can be dangerous. I didn't know this. Okay, I didn't know that there are hormones out there to block puberty. I mean, this is serious stuff. You're injecting hormones or taking pills that stop you from going through puberty. Reversible or not, puberty-blocking hormones indicate a state of disease and the absence of puberty, and inhibit growth and fertility in a previously biological healthy child. Okay, so here you got a biologically healthy child, and you're giving it drugs in order to stop a natural occurrence called puberty. I can't believe I heard that, or that this is happening. And if this is happening and we have parents doing this to their kids, or if we have the government doing this to their kids, these parents, these government people, these doctors who support this behavior need to be prosecuted for child abuse. It needs to be put on as a law that this is child abuse. It's just unbelievable that that could be happening. And if you know of it happening, or you know somebody doing it, let me know. This is horrific. According to the DSM-5, as many as 98% of gender-confused boys and 88% of gender-confused girls eventually accept their biological sex after naturally passing through puberty. And you can see why that would happen, you know. The parents could be confusing them, society can be confusing them, but guess what? Biology helps them figure it out. You look in the mirror, you know. Oh, I am a boy, you know. But of course, the attempt in our society today is to have this confusion and to create this confusion and cause these problems in these kids' lives. And why? There's a reason why, and we'll get into that next week. Okay. Children who use puberty blockers to impersonate the opposite sex will require cross-sex hormones in late adolescence. Cross-sex hormones, testosterone and estrogen, are associated with dangerous health risks, including but not limited to high blood pressure, blood clots, stroke, and cancer. Okay, so the child already using puberty blockers to help them impersonate the opposite sex already has health problems, but they're also going to require cross-sex hormones in late adolescence. So testosterone and estrogen, and they're associated with dangerous health risks, including but not limited to high blood pressure, blood clots, cancer, stroke, and cancer. Tough deal. Is this what you want for your child? So figure this out. You're trying to force your child into a mold, or you're not directing your child as to what they are and who they are. You're hurting your child. Rates of suicide are 20 times greater among adults who use cross-sex hormones and undergo sex reassignment surgery. Even in Sweden, which is among the most LGBTQ-affirming countries. 20 times greater among adults. And it doesn't matter whether you're, your society approves of this or not. What compassionate and reasonable person will condemn young children to this fate, knowing that after puberty, as many as 88% of girls and 98% of all boys will eventually accept the reality and achieve a state of mental and physical health? Why subject them to the potential of suicide by confusing them? Okay, last point. Conditioning children into believing that a lifetime of chemical and surgical impersonation of the opposite sex is normal and healthful is child abuse. That's what these pediatricians are stating, and key psychologists. Endorsing gender discordance as normal via public education and legal policies will confuse children and parents, leading more children to present to gender clinics where they will be given puberty-blocking drugs. This, in turn, virtually assures that they will choose a mutilation of their healthy body parts as young adults. Michelle Critella, Quentin Van Meter, and Paul McHugh wrote this report. St. Paul School, you're abusing kids. You need to stop it. And stop it now. All right, remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week.
You said to me that you wouldn't leave, but now I see that you're long gone. Sets on fire.